taking over me with the love that never stops, forever caught. You call me by my name and now I'll never be the same. We will never stop, fought the wind your love caused. You're irresistible, you're irresistible. Lord, we praise you. Nothing satisfies like you.
Compassion uncompromising, favor freely give. What kindness can forgive the darkness of my sin?
All right, good morning, everyone. It's good to see you all here in the house of the Lord. If you're happy to be here, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, so let me cover our announcements as we get started this morning. Cindy has asked me to announce that the ladies' Bible study will begin tonight. The Bible study that is called, what is it now, Cindy? It's the ladies' Bible study. All right. There is a particular theme, and with the Master, okay, with the Master in heavenly places, and they will meet in the fellowship hall. So ladies, that's right after the evening service. Evening service is at 5:30-ish. Then we'll go into our Bible study. So ladies' Bible study around 5:30. All right, there was another one. We have our quarterly business meeting is coming up this Wednesday evening at 6 o'clock. So if you've got any business to bring before the church, then this Wednesday at 6 o'clock we will have our quarterly business meeting. Our choir is going to begin practicing this evening at 4:15. So if you are interested in joining our choir, we would love to have you come and sing with us. Brother Clay is going to lead us in some specials and that sort of thing. So we'll meet at 4:15 this afternoon. And practice. So everybody pray about joining the choir. And we always have a good time. So y'all know that. Y'all see us whenever we are singing cantatas and that sort of thing. We always enjoy singing to the Lord. So pray about that. All right, this coming Saturday, there's the Area 7 GA Missions Madness for the girls at First Baptist Church Crystal Springs. And if you need more information about that, see Miss Nicole Deer. She can let you know about that. The church will be sending the bus up, or there's a group going for sure. So if you need any more information, see Miss Nicole. And also, on April the 30th, next Sunday evening for the Awana classes, the kids are encouraged to do a dress-up day. And the theme of it is, what do you want to be when you grow up? So kids, whatever you want to be when you grow up, come dressed as that next Sunday evening for the service. I will be in revival starting next Sunday morning at Big Springs Baptist Church, and the revival will go through Wednesday of that week. We'll have Sunday morning, Sunday evening, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday nights at Big Springs. So y'all please be praying for me in that. Next Sunday morning, we have a guest speaker from the Gideons coming. He will come and have the morning service, and Brother Billy Joe Deer will be back for our Sunday evening service at 5 o'clock. So y'all pray for those guys, and they will be having the services next Sunday. On May the 7th, we're going to have a graduate recognition for our morning service. We also have a guest speaker for that day, Miss Cecile. Oh, I can't remember her last name now. From the crisis, the Center for Pregnancy Choices in Lawrence County, she's going to be coming to make a presentation, and also we're going to have a graduate recognition that morning. So everybody be praying for that. Then on Mother's Day, which is the next week, all right. So the men are going to be cooking breakfast for the church on Mother's Day, and breakfast will start at 9 a.m. The men will be cooking. And then we'll eat at 9 a.m., have a Sunday school at 10, and then our morning worship, which will be the baby dedication worship service. So everybody be praying for that. And then there are no evening services for Mother's Day. All right. Are there any other announcements this morning? Did I get them all? Okay. Yes, ma'am. Joe is cancer-free. Praise the Lord. He went back, got his checkup, and they said he's clear. Awesome. Joe Honey is cancer-free, so we can take him off our prayer list, the cancer warriors. Amen. All right. Anyone else that we need to pray for this morning as we begin our service? Mr. Donnie and Miss Debbie. Right. Ray is going to have an MRI done before too long on his back, so be praying for Ray. Ron's uncle, he did well in his surgery, so praise the Lord for that. And Mr. Dwayne's still under the weather with pneumonia, so be praying for him. And Miss Dixine, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Okay, yes, ma'am. All right, so he's got two. Right. Okay, yes, ma'am. All right, anyone else before we pray? All right, well, let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask for his blessings on our gathering this morning. Brother Freddie, would you mind lifting us up this morning? Amen. Thank you, brother. Brother Clay.
Ready? All right, y'all. Y'all stand with me. Turn to hymn number 595 or follow along on the screen. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. This will be our fellowship hymn as well. 595. There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless wave. Send the light. our souls to save. Send the light, send the light, send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light. Let it shine forevermore. Now go everybody stay, shake their hand.
Send the light.
blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore. Send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine forevermore. Amen. Y'all can have a seat. Flip on back, hymn number 469. 469, revive us again. 469. We praise thee, O God, for the sign of thy love, for Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. Number two. We praise thee, O God, for thy Spirit of light, who has shown us our Savior and scattered our night. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. Number three. All glory and praise to the Lamb that was slain, who has borne all our sins and had cleansed every stain. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again. And the last, revive us again, fill each heart with thy love, may soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive again. Amen. Flip on over hymn number 559. Rescue the perishing. 559. Are y'all glad to be here this morning? Amen. I'm glad y'all are. I am too. Here we go. Rescue the perishing. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, snatch them in pity from sin and the grave. Weep o'er the erring one, lift up the fallen, tell them of Jesus, the mighty to save. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Number two, though they are slighting him, still he is waiting, waiting the penitent child to receive. Plead with him earnestly, plead with him gently, he will forgive if they only believe. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. Number three, down in the human heart, crushed by the tempter, feelings lie buried that grace can restore. Touched by a loving heart, wakened by kindness, cords that are broken will vibrate once more. Rescue the perishing, care for the dying, Jesus is merciful, Jesus will save. And the last, rescue the perishing, duty demands it, strength for thy labor the Lord will provide. Back is merciful, Jesus will save. Amen. Y'all stand back up with me. Flip on back. Hymn number 194. This will be an offertory hymn. 194. The King is coming. 194. Sounding, and now his face I see. Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. Praise God, he's coming for me.
Heavenly Father, we just come to you again, Lord. We just thank you for this day that you've given us, Lord. We just thank you for what you did on the cross, Lord. You laid down your life innocent of all things, so we would live innocent to the Father.
Amen.
Lord, we just be with the ones on the prayer list today, Lord, and just bless these tithes and offerings. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Wendell. Appreciate you, brother. All right. Brother Clay, thank you for leading us. What was that, Charlie? I do appreciate you, Wendell. You're doing a great job. God's good all the time, right? He takes folks like us and allows us to be a part of what he's doing, and I praise the Lord for that. He could even use somebody like Charlie, if Charlie would let him. Praise the Lord. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Take your Bibles and turn with me to John chapter 14. In John chapter 14, this morning we're going to close out the chapter. We've been studying through the book of John, and we've gotten here to the closing of chapter 14. And I've got a confession to make. I messaged Clay yesterday. I think it was early, maybe morning, lunchtime or something. And I told him, I said, you know, we're going to be focusing on revival tomorrow morning. The theme is the revival. I've been studying and trying to get ready for and prepared for the revival at Big Springs, and the Lord I've gotten some messages put together, and I'm ready, excited about going there. So I was feeling really good about revival. And this morning I woke up with this passage of Scripture on my mind. And although I was ready to preach about revival and about how we are challenged to be revived, the Lord changed the message. So I messaged Clay back this morning. I said, you know, it's been a little bit of a change. I said, we're not going to be talking about revival specifically, but we're going back to the book of John, and we're going to be talking about the things in chapter 14 again. And he said he was looking forward to revival, something of that nature. He texted me back, and I said, well, let's keep the music the same. I said, and the theme is basically the same, because right here in chapter 14, we're talking about, the title of the message this morning is, Do You Love Me? And this is the thought that is in this passage of Scripture. You remember when Christ Jesus was talking to Peter after his resurrection and after Peter's denial of Jesus, and they're sitting there together, and Jesus looks at him and says, Do you love me? And Peter says, yes, I love you. And then Jesus, waiting probably a moment, I'm picturing this in my mind. I don't know exactly how it went, but I think that he paused just a little bit. They may have talked about something else for a minute, but then he looked at Peter again and said, do you love me? And Peter said, yes, Lord, I love you. And then after a little bit again, Jesus looked at him the third time and said, do you love me? And then Peter, I think he finally got through to Peter. So Peter said this, Lord, you know all things. In other words, Jesus knew the answer to the question that he was asking Peter. And Jesus finally got all the way down to where Peter, bare bones, where the rubber meets the road, where everything stopped, everything else that was happening, and Peter says, you know, Lord, you know everything about me. You know exactly who I am. You know exactly how I feel. And not only that, you know exactly where I'm going. You know that I love you. In our passage of Scripture this morning, Jesus talks about our love for Him. So I'm going to present to you the question this morning, do you love Him? His question to you is, do you love me? So let's read our passage of Scripture this morning, beginning in verse 19, John chapter 14, starting in verse 19, reading through the end of the chapter. Jesus says, a little while longer, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you will live also. At that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me, and he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. You have heard me say to you, I am going away and coming back to you. If you loved me, you would rejoice because I said, I am going to the Father. For my Father is greater than I. And now I have told you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may believe. I will no longer talk much with you, for the ruler of this world is coming, and he has nothing in me. But that the world may know that I love the Father, and as the Father gave me commandment, so I do. Arise, let us go from here. The question this morning is, do you love me? Let's pray, please. Our God and King, we bow before you today because you are master of all. You have brought us forth. And Father, we are because of you. We have nothing, we are nothing without you. Help us to seek you with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Your word says if we seek you, you will be found by us. You will come to us. So Lord, this morning we ask for your Holy Spirit to be moving in us, teaching us what we need to know, reminding us of what the Lord Jesus said, but also drawing us close to you through obedience. Father, here we are gathered in your name, seeking you. Have your way with us. I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you love me? All right, in this passage of Scripture, I've looked and found three things, and that's a surprise to you, isn't it? As a Southern Baptist, we get three things out of everything. I think it just we stop at three, okay? So this morning, we're going to be looking at three things, and the first thing that I want you to see out of this passage of Scripture is the promise of life. The promise of life. Go back to verse 19. Verse 19 and 20. I will a little while longer and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Jesus says, because I live, you will live also. Because I live, you will live also. Now here he is. He's speaking to those that are around him who are alive. So to them, their mind is, I am living now. But Jesus is not talking about just this life. He's talking about life everlasting. He's talking about if you want true life, if you want real life, then you will follow me. He's already told them that. You are, can come to where I'm going. And then, of course, Thomas, not Philip, one of them. You know, I messed that up last week. Anyway, one of them said, where are you going? We don't know. And Jesus went on and talked to him a little more. But here's the thing. We can follow the Lord Jesus Christ, and He wants us to know His life. He wants us to live His life. He wants us to follow Him so that our life reflects His life. And here He promises, because I live, you live also. You will live. I'm reminded of our song, Because He Lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow because He lives. All fear is gone because He lives. How awesome. Think about it. Without Jesus, our life literally means nothing. And it amounts to nothing. And in the end, we won't cease to be. We will forever be without Jesus in a place of torment. So seek out Jesus. He wants you to have His life. For you not to have His life is for you to reject Him completely and say, no, I will not. And that might seem surprising to us, but you know, we do it a whole lot. There are many people today who think they have a relationship with Jesus that do not. So Jesus says, first of all, I want you to have life. I promise you life, but that life is in Christ Jesus our Lord. At that day you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. Jesus says, we're all going to be together. Not only are you going to be with us, but we will be with you. There's a difference between you being with someone else and someone else being with you. You see, I can be with I go to a concert. I went to a concert not too long ago. I can go to a concert and be with Zach Williams. But he's not with me. Yeah, I'm sitting in the crowd watching him, right? And listening to him. So I am with him, but he's not with me. He's up there with all of his people singing and playing his band, that sort of thing. So he's with them, but I'm with him. I'm outside of that. Outside of the personal group that he's in. You see, you can know about Jesus, and you can even be in church. You can be hearing messages all the time, praising the Lord Jesus, and even doing things for Him, but not know Him, not be with Him. You can be with Him, but He may not be with you, because you have not invited Him to be with you. You have not asked Him to forgive you. You have not given yourself over to Him so that wherever He is, you will be too. Jesus promises us life, and He wants us to understand that there is life everlasting. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 20, listen to this. And now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. After Christ died, He was resurrected on the third day so that we could have this life that He's talking about. So that we could live past this life. Our, you know, our old bodies, this tent that we live in, this clay pot. We are going to shed these things one day. We're going to go to another existence. It's either life with Him or continuous, everlasting torment away from Him. Hell. Now, Jesus says, I promise you life. Because I live, you will live also. And then, look at verse 28 with me. There's a promise of life here. You have heard me say to you, I am going away and coming back to you. If you love me, you would rejoice because I said, I am going to the Father, for my Father is greater than I. Jesus says, you've heard me talk about this life. You've heard me talk about how I'm living now, how I'm going to die, but how I'm going to come back to life and live with the Father. And you can have that life as well. And He says, if you really loved me, you would rejoice that I'm going home to be with the Father. And by the way, that's where He was in the beginning and all the way through eternity until He came to earth. And then He lived His life some 33 or so years. And then He was crucified, He was dead, buried, resurrected, and then He went back home to be with the Father. And He says, rejoice that I get to go back to my Father. And He says, rejoice so, not that I won't be with you, but rejoice that you're able to come and be with me. And that's where the rejoicing comes. We have nothing to rejoice about here and now in this world physically. But here's the thing. There's only hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. This world is fading away. Fast. It's picking up speed. It's headed downhill with the foot on the accelerator, pressing harder and harder. But listen. We sing another song, and it begins this way. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King. Because He lives. Or He lives, He lives, He lives. I wish I could sing the whole thing, but you know how my mind works. I get ahead of myself and I forget the lyrics. All right. Rejoice because He lives. He lives, He lives. How do I know He lives? He lives in me. Jesus is offer of everlasting life. He offers you life to the full here and now, and also everlasting life, abundant life past this that we cannot imagine right now. But He offers it because He lives. And then, look at verse 29 with me. And now, I have told you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may believe. Jesus says, they're going to kill me. They're going to crucify me on the cross. They're going to bury me, but I'm coming back for you. I'm coming back. So He makes this promise of life. He says, first of all, rejoice that I'm going to my Father, but also I want you to know that I have done everything that the Father has asked me to do, completely obedient. As a matter of fact, on the cross, Jesus says, it is finished. He said, it's finished. The work is done. The mission is complete. Salvation in full is accomplished. Now, you know what He said in John chapter 14, verse 3. He says, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And He says, I've told you ahead of time so that when it comes about, it will strengthen your faith. You will believe. So Jesus gives us the promise of life. Then, let's go to verses 25 through 27. There's the promise of life in the first section. Now I want you to see the provision of help. The provision of help. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Jesus promises us His provision of help. He says, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is going to be a down payment, a deposit of your salvation. This thing is, I'm sorry, Clay. I keep bumping it or something. I don't know. I got it in the wrong spot. The provision of the help of the Holy Spirit, Jesus says, I'm leaving, but you don't have to worry. I'm going to send somebody that will take better care of you than I can. He's going to be in you. He's going to be the down payment, the deposit of your salvation. So He will lead you. He will guide you. He will do all these things. Jesus says, first of all, He's going to teach you. The Holy Spirit is going to teach you. Look what He says in verse 26. The helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, He will teach you all things. He's going to teach you all things. He's going to show you the things that you don't know. Sometimes I hear people say, well, I read the Bible and I can't understand it. It's this and it's that and it's just beyond me. I can't do it. You know what? Ask the Holy Spirit to show you the meaning of the passage of Scripture and He will. That's what the Holy Spirit does. He teaches you. When we desire to be taught. Now, He's not going to come down and just give you everything. He can do that. He has done that before. He caused Solomon to be the wisest man ever while he was still in his early 20s. You see, and He does bless people with all knowledge and all sorts of things, but your desire plays a part in it. What do you want? Do you want to know more about the Scriptures? Do you want the Holy Spirit to illuminate the Scriptures for you so that you can understand it? Then ask Him and He will. He is the helper and He teaches. Not only does He teach, it says that He reminds. Jesus says, He will remind you, bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. You know what? The folks in those days didn't have a record, a written record of Jesus' sayings and teachings. They were doing the best they could. Somebody might have been recording some things, but they didn't have the Bible like we have now. We take it for granted. They didn't have it. They had to remember it. It had to become a part of them. And Jesus says, the Holy Spirit's coming. And when you accept Christ as Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit is given to you to live within you, to teach you the things that He taught, and also to remind you of the things that He taught. So whenever we are walking through our life, whenever we're living out our daily existence, wherever it may be, if we're asking the Holy Spirit to show us how to live holy lives, He's going to do that. If we are submitting to Him and following His guiding, His leading, then He's going to show us the right way to go. But if we ignore Him, we're turning off the light. We're turning away from Him. If we don't listen to Him, you see, we're going to be listening to somebody else, and that will allow them to be louder than the Holy Spirit in us, and we're going to follow the loudest voice. When you ignore the Holy Spirit living within inside of you, the Scripture says that you grieve the Holy Spirit. He desires for you the best life now. Wait a minute. That was Joel Osteen. I'm sorry. I don't want to do anything Joel Osteen does, okay? The Holy Spirit allows you to live a life that is pleasing unto Christ, and our best life is not now, it's to come. So now, He helps us by teaching us and reminding us, and then it says in verse 27, Jesus says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Jesus' peace and comfort comes through the Holy Spirit in our life. The Holy Spirit living within us, the comfort that we need, the peace that we need is there when we allow Him to minister to us. I can't remember who it was, but it may have been Brother Billy Joe, because he talks about hunting dogs a lot. But wait a minute now. It might have been Eli too. It may have been Jerry Clower, but he said something about coon dogs fighting. But then the one that you feed the most is the one who's going to be the strongest and the one who can run the hardest, and he will have the most energy. And whenever we're talking about the Holy Spirit and our physical nature, you know, what we feed the most is going to be the strongest. What we focus on and give preference to is going to be the strongest. The way that we walk is the way that we're going to be used to walking, and we're going to try to continue in that way. That's just our nature. But if we are given over to the Holy Spirit, He is stronger and He guides us. And when we follow Him, it's easier to follow continuously than it is to do it intermittently. And if we're continuously following the Holy Spirit, He's going to teach us, He's going to guide us, He's going to give the peace and comfort that only He can give us in Christ Jesus our Lord. But Jesus tells us, He promises us life, and He promises us the provision of help through the Holy Spirit. But there's something else in this passage of Scripture, and this is where I really wanted to focus on this morning. There is a proof of love. A proof of love. Listen to what Jesus said in verse 21. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. All right. Then look at verse 23. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. Verse 24. He who does not love me does not keep my words. You see the theme? Jesus says in verse 31 that He has kept the commandments of God. In the other verses of Scripture, it says that we are supposed to keep His commandments. Jesus says, anyone wants to follow me must die daily, take up his cross, and follow me. You see, most of us, most of Southern Baptist life, most people in the world believe in an easy salvation. We think that all we have to do is pray a prayer and get dunked in the water and everything's good. We don't have to do anything else. You know what? Our salvation is not based on what we do, but if we are saved, we're going to gladly serve our Lord, our God, our King. We're not going to sit and sour in the pew. We're going to take up arms. We're going to fight for the King. We're going to make sure that we are building His kingdom. You see, the thing is, Jesus says, if you love me, you're going to keep my commandments. People are going to see that you follow me. So let me ask you a question. With all of your friends and relations, do they know that you're a Christ follower by what you do? Jesus says, if you're mine, if you're one of my sheep, you're going to follow me because He's the shepherd. Are we living our life in such a fashion so that people will know without the shadow of a doubt that we belong to Christ? Because here's the truth. If you say you're a Christ follower and you're not walking with Him, if you're walking in the other direction, I doubt whether you belong to Him or not. Because He says, if you love me, you're going to follow me. If you love me, you're going to keep my commandments. And if you're not loving Him, it's because you're not keeping His commandments. Jesus says, there's proof. There's going to be proof in the life of those who love the Lord. They're going to follow the Lord. They're going to seek Him. They're going to obey His commandments. It's going to be obvious to the world, because we should stand out so to the world that they will not have any doubt that we're different than them. Love manifests itself in action. Jesus says, he who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. So your belief, your love will lead you to act upon that belief and love. If you have a strong love, you're going to have strong actions. If you have weak love, you're going to have weak actions. So look, are we working out? Are we lifting weights, trying to get stronger? Are we asking the Holy Spirit to move in us so that our actions will be stronger and stronger for the Lord Jesus Christ? Are we happy with where we are? We've got our salvation. We're just going to sit on it and wait for the Lord to come. I don't think he's going to be happy with that. As a matter of fact, he told a parable about that, about a person receiving a talent and sitting on it or burying it. And then he turned it back over to the Lord. Here it is. This is what's yours. And he's like, that's not the way it works. Now, that's my interpretation, okay? Jesus didn't say that. But he said this. I gave it to you so that you would put it to work. And so that the increase could be mine. Jesus gives you your life so that you could put it to work so that his kingdom can be multiplied, and the purpose of you living is to glorify the kingdom and multiply the kingdom, to cause increase to the kingdom, not for our honor and glory, but for his, because it's his kingdom. We're honoring the king when we seek to bring other people into the kingdom and to see the kingdom grow. Love will manifest itself in action. Verses 23 and 24, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Loving him equals following and obeying him. You know, honestly, I'm tired of hearing people say, oh yeah, I'm saved. Oh yeah, I'm a Christian. Oh, I love Jesus. Yeah. Okay. Why didn't I know that? Why didn't I see that in you? I've told y'all the story of this one time before. There was a young lady that I had met that I was her pastor for a while when she was a child. And I saw her a couple of years later, and she had grown up, of course, and she came back, and I said, hey, where are y'all going to church? Oh, well, we're not attending church right now. And I said, well, you know, how is that? And she said, oh, I love Jesus. And I said, really? How long has it been since you worshiped him? And her sister was standing over there close to her, and she started laughing. She said, oh, he got you there. Because she knew the truth. And she wasn't trying to pretend like the other sister was. Listen, folks. This is serious. This is not a game we're playing. This is the creator of the universe who knows all things. He knows everything about you. He knows if you really are saved or not. And he's not going to settle for a part-time Christian. By the way, there's no such thing. You see, and a whole lot of people, they want to ride the fence, and they want the best of this world and the best of that world. Let me tell you what, there is no fence. You either belong to him or you don't. And Jesus says, for those who love me, they will follow me. They will keep my commands. So here's what I take out of that. You'll be able to see someone walking with Christ, walking for Christ, living their life for Christ, and know that they're a Christian. For those who you have questions about, maybe they're doing things that you don't see. But if their life continuously leads you to believe that they don't know Christ, then most likely they don't. And it's my prayer that there's nobody like that sitting here this morning. But if there is, there's hope in the Lord Jesus Christ. There's help in the Lord Jesus Christ. He wants to save you. He wants to give you his life. He wants to look at you and say, well done, good and faithful servant. But it depends on you bowing the knee to him and following him continuously. Are you willing? Are you ready? Do you love him? Because it shows if you do, and it shows if you don't. Jesus completely obeyed the Father all the way to the cross. Obedient unto death. And you know, sometimes we can't be obedient enough to come to worship. Will that please the Master? His question to us today is, do you love me? And the answer to that is, if you are keeping His commandments, you love Him. Because He says, if you love me, keep my commandments. Live like it. Behave like you love Jesus and not the world. This morning, if you felt the Holy Spirit convict you of your lostness, the fact that you need Jesus and that you haven't trusted Him completely, or maybe you've not committed your whole life to Him, would you give yourself to Him today? Because it's a wholesale commitment. It's not part-time. It's all or nothing. And the Lord Jesus wants you because He has life for you. During our invitation time, if the Lord has spoken to you, make your way into the aisle, come down here and say, I need Jesus. He wants to save you. He will save you now. Pray with me, please. Father, we do praise Your holy name. And we thank You for Your holy word. How it moves in our hearts and convicts us of the sin that is within us. Lord, help us to strive to be holy in Your sight. And Father, during this invitation time, I ask for You to convict those that are here that have not accepted Christ as Lord and Savior to come forward and say, it's me, I need Jesus. And for those who have walked away, those who have not been completely committed, Father, help them to come and say, I want Jesus and I'm going to give Him all. Father, whatever Your will is for us today, I ask for Your blessing. I pray that You accomplish Your purpose here in this invitation time. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand for a hymn of invitation.
Hymn number 324.
Hymn 324. And whatever the Lord has spoken to you this morning, you follow Him in obedience.
Have you been to the cross where the Lord Jesus suffered? Calvary, have you been to the place of redemption for sinners? Have you been to Calvary? It was there on Calvary, God's dear Son Jesus.